Hello everyone. In this video, we're diving into the inner workings of this SSD 1306 based OLED display that we managed to initialize in the last video, and looking a bit at how we can use it with basically any 6502 based computer, like the Commodore 64, Apple 1 and 2, Benito's breadboard computer, or my very own 6502 single board computers for that matter. Of course, making the display show random dots isn't much of a feat, but by getting this far, we should have gotten a pretty good grasp on how I2C works at the bit level. If you're a hardware hacker like me, I can promise you that will come in handy at some point. Before we get to the fun stuff, I have two important announcements to make. The first announcement will probably explain why I suddenly have a ring on my finger that I didn't have in the last video. I got married! So, if I sound a bit cheerier than usual in this video, that's just what marrying the love of your life will do to you. In other news, I'm making this video during my summer break at a secret location in the former Soviet Union, so a few things will be slightly improvised and I'm using a different microphone and otherwise making do with what I have. Making YouTube videos in the summer sun isn't half bad. But let's get back to the fun stuff. If you haven't seen the previous video, it's not a strict requirement, but if you'd like to know more about the 6502ino we're using here, or get the grand tour of the I2C protocol, you should check that out. We'll be using 6502 assembly code to make the display text, but since we already wrote our I2C driver in the previous video, the basic principle will be the same if you try to make your own display library in C, C++, Python, any other language. Since we already have the I2C part figured out, from now it's basically just a matter of figuring out what bytes to send to the IC hidden inside the display module. Now, how would we go about figuring that out? We could start Googling it and we'd probably get 1,000 examples of differing quality we could dissect, but if you've seen some of my other videos, you've probably guessed it. We'll be taking a look at the datasheet for the Solomon SSD 1306, which is a very common controller chip to be embedded in this type of monochrome OLED display. The IC itself also supports SPI, the common serial peripheral interface, which is why you might have a module with more pins than this one. And that should allow for faster updates to the display than using I2C like we're doing here. If you'd like to see SPI in action on a 6502 system, I made a video on that a while back where I connected my 6502 single board computer to a common RF module. If I was making a product based on this display and a 6502, I might make my own PCB and use the third option, the parallel interface, since that would probably make it 8 times faster than SPI, not to mention I2C, at the expense of using more pins or requiring glue logic hardware, of course. But that's certainly out of scope for this video. As we see on page 20, controlling the display is a normal I2C transaction and a simple matter of sending the address followed by a control byte, which indicates if this is a command or data transaction. The continuation bit, called CO, can be used to indicate if all the following bytes are data or a combination of data and commands. If we set it to 0, we don't have to send a control byte between each data byte and we can just keep clocking data. The data command bit tells us whether the following byte is data to be shown on the display or a control command. The display has some cursor position registers, but since we don't care where on the display we start clearing, we don't need to think about that now. With that knowledge, we can actually clear the display and start writing something to it. So let's start writing some assembly code. As you might remember from last time, the 6502ino cold starts too fast for the display charge pump to be ready. So to fix that, we should introduce a delay before initializing the display. We can just copy the 6532 timer code we used for the blink delay into a subroutine and call that. First, we start the I2C transaction and send the control byte with only the command bit set, aka 40 hex, to indicate we're sending a bunch of data bytes only. The display is 128 by 64 pixels organized into 128 columns and 8 pages. GDRAM, the graphics data RAM of the display, consists of 8 vertical bits per byte on a single column, so we can clear the whole display by sending 1024 blank bytes. To do that efficiently, we should use an index register to count the bytes we're sending, but since the X and Y registers are only 8 bits wide, we'll need to use both, or a memory location for an inner loop and an outer loop. To make things easy, I'll use the Y register for the inner loop and use a variable to hold our outer loop counter, and only put it in the X register when counting, since we're also using X for the I2C routines. It's pretty easy math to figure out an inner loop of 128 columns and an outer loop of 8 pages will clear each pixel on the display. But it'll be a little bit faster if the inner loop is 256 columns, or said another way, 2 pages, and the outer loop is 4, so each iteration of our inner loop clears a quarter of the display, since there's some overhead each time we complete an inner loop when we fetch the X register from memory. I hope you're still with me after that mouthful. As a quick test to see if our clear screen routine works, we can call it when we push the user button on the board. That currently just changes the blink speed while we hold it down. And of course, we have to remember to declare our new memory location to hold X temporarily. So, if we burn that to ROM, we should see that the display still initializes semi-randomly and then clears when we push the button. Yay! It's a little bit hard to see, but since it cleared completely, it looks like our math was correct, and we can move on to writing some pixels to screen. Oh, and if we reset the CPU now, we shouldn't see anything change, since the GDRAM is only semi-random on power-up, so reinitializing it doesn't change what's on the screen, except for some reason on the top left, it does look like the screen is outputting a single byte on reset. I'm not sure what that's about, since it doesn't seem to be coming from the initialization routine, but since we'll probably clear the screen after each reset anyway, we don't really have to worry about it. Now let's think a bit about how we'll actually write text. The way most of the display libraries for these modules work is that they keep a local frame buffer of what's supposed to be on the screen and then focus on manipulating that and sending it to the other frame buffer in the screen controller as fast as possible. But as you might remember, the only RAM we have on the 6502ino is the 128 bytes inside the 6532. So we're going to have a hard time fitting 128 by 64 pixels, or 1024 bytes, into that. Luckily, we don't have to send out the whole screen of pixels at a time. If we keep track of the cursor position, we can send as little as a byte at a time, which for us is 8 vertical pixels. So how do we turn that into text? Well, we simply draw each letter one 8-pixel column at a time. Of course, we don't want to do that every time we want to put a letter on the screen, so what we're going to do is to make a routine that accepts an ASCII character code as input and then draws the letter from a lookup table. The lookup table the routine gets the letter data from, I'm sure you already know by a different name. A font. A bitmap font file. If you're following along with this, you'll be happy to know that you don't have to type each column of each letter, and you don't even have to watch me do it, since I cheated a bit and did that beforehand. Actually, it's not just one lookup table, but 5, since our font here is 5 by 7 pixels. By putting each column in a separate table, our character write routine can just keep the same ASCII character in the Y register and grab each column. Instead of pasting the whole font into the assembly source, I'm just using the CC65 include directive to pull in the font file. Since our screen is 128 columns, and that's not evenly divisible by our 5 font columns, we can just add some blank padding columns before and after. So each character takes up an 8x8 pixel square. and each line holds an even 16 characters. Since we're also a bit constrained for ROM space, I decided to skip the first 32 ASCII characters in the font file since, well, since they're not characters, but usually control characters like carriage return, new line, or bell. To work with that, we simply have the assembler deduct 32 or 20 hex from the column lookup table addresses. Of course, that also means we'll be sending junk to the display if we try to print control characters, but let's cross that bridge when we get to it and assume for now that we only try to send real characters to the display. Okay. This routine should now be ready to print a single character, but I'm feeling confident that'll work great. So let's also write a routine to send a whole zero-terminated string before we test it. You know, whole sentences. To make a generally useful string printing routine, I like to use indirect y-indexed mode and a pointer to ROM. Said another way, we simply give the routine an address for where in ROM the string is located. We simply reset y and then keep fetching new characters until we get a zero byte. Sadly, we need to save y since sending the character destroys y, but at least we can reuse the xtemp memory location since we only use that when we clear the display. After we send the character and reload y, we move on to the next character and use branch not equal to always loop since y should never roll over from 255 to 0. Especially since our display can only hold 128 characters. When the string is sent, we simply finish the I2C transaction and return. So now we have a routine to print a string, and all that's left is to load our pointer with an absolute address to the string. I have a carefully crafted ASCII welcome message ready in my clipboard, and we just load the low address byte into the pointer and the high address byte into the next memory location. That way, we can use the same routine to print a string from anywhere in memory. But of course, let's see if it works before we declare victory. The display still boots up with a semi-random frame buffer, but when we push the button, we successfully see the welcome message. That's a win! If we press the reset button, not much happens except the cursor position is reset, but if we only press the user button, we'll see the message is reprinted from the cursor position it got to, instead of starting from the top. But of course, that's exactly what we should expect, and I'm super happy with what we've accomplished with just a few bytes of RAM and a 1 MHz processor in an Arduino clone form factor. It really looks great, so much better than on video. The refresh rate is making it look much dimmer than it really is, and the screen brightness is only set at about 50%. I can really imagine making this more of a standalone device, add some more buttons, and even playing games on it, but I think now might be a good time to take a break. In the next video, we'll complete the display library, add a few more basic routines to set the column and page, maybe some graphics, but more importantly, we'll add serial to the 65 Arduino. That means we can send text to display on the 65 Arduino from a computer or other serial device for that matter. And even better, we can use it to load a little bit of software to the 65 Arduino without reflashing the ROM. There's so much more fun to be had with a 6502 computer in this form factor, and I hope you'll join me. If you have any ideas about what we should do with it, I'd love a comment. For now, all I have left to say is thanks for watching.